سبحان الله عما يشركون.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها النبي إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا. صدق الله العظيم. My dear respected brothers and any sisters listening through the speaker system, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Come on guys, I know it's a Saturday night and you're probably missing out on something out there, but you've made a sacrifice to come here. We can do better, inshallah. The topic is about the youth around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And one of the striking things is that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he managed to not only connect with the people of his own age, he not only managed to connect up with the people who were above his age, but he also managed to connect with people who were under his age. And this is a beauty of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's character. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the one hand, he's able to make his mind go higher and make his mind go lower. So on the one hand, he marries a woman who is 15 years old, 15 years older than him, Khadija radiallahu anha, and they connect together as if Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at the age of 25, when he married this woman who was 40, as if they were the same age. And later on he marries another individual much, much younger than him, Aisha radiallahu anha, who is about 9, and at that time he's 53 when she comes to his house. So the difference between them is quite a lot. It's almost just above 40 years of a difference. But again, he connects with her just as he connected with Khadija radiallahu anha. Now, this is a beauty, and we haven't got much time to mention all the different Sahaba, we haven't got time to mention all the youngsters that were around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But perhaps a few things that would answer the question, why is it that the youth were so attached to him? This would be a principle of many principles, which is that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from his own sayings, he tells us, "Anzilin nas manazilahum," place people in their own statuses, whatever status they belong to, place them in that. "Kallimun nas qadra uqulihim," speak to people according to their understanding, what they can understand. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a prime example of demonstrating that. So when he spoke to children, he spoke to them on their level. And when he spoke to elders, he spoke to them to their level. Many of us have a problem trying to switch that far apart. Some of us can switch maybe a 10-year of a gap. Some of us maybe a 20-year of a gap. But to switch between the 50, 60-year-olds and the 10-year-olds or the below 10-year-olds, which we'll see, and I'll talk to you about ahadith which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do, it's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. It's not everybody's character that you can blend in with that much of a variety of people. So this was one key factor which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had, and each person that came around him, they saw him just as a beehive and bees are around trying to rest or trying to find the sweetness in the beehive. So each and every individual wanted to take something from this beehive. And they were all able to. So when even the senior Sahaba were around, it didn't mean that the young Sahaba were left out. And when this young Sahaba were around, it didn't mean that these senior Sahaba were left out. And when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave his duties, he didn't just select the most senior and the most experienced of them. And it's very evident in what he did, is that he had around him, he attracted in his early days of his mission, he sallallahu alaihi wasallam attracted more youngsters than those who were of middle age and above middle age. It is very clear in the seerah. So even when you see Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he enters Islam, he's only 27 years old. Later on, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he appoints Mu'adh bin Jabal radiallahu anhu as the governor of Yemen, as the whole governor of this entire, almost like a country. The age of Sayyidina Mu'adh bin Jabal radiallahu anhu was 27. He was 27. He wasn't above that. When Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiallahu anhu, he goes and he converts most of Medina in terms of the Aus and Khazraj. When he converts most of the Aus and Khazraj in Medina, again, he's a very young Sahabi. At the age of about 17 or 18. That's his age, 17 or 18. Now, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to decide, just before making, you know, just before getting the command of Hijrah, who is he to send to Medina or Yathrib at that time it was called? Who was he going to send over there? He sallallahu alaihi wasallam decided he's going to be Mus'ab bin Umayr. Why? Because he's seeing a young individual who's very passionate in what he believes. And this was another feature amongst the young Sahaba. And why were they so passionate? And the question that we need to ask is, if I find youngsters around me who are not connected to me, which sunnah have I lost? This is a key question. What is that sunnah that I've lost? Because if I'm always acting like a 40 or a 50 year old, and even when I'm with kids, I'm still acting like a 40 and 50 year old, and I've got the right to do that. I've got the right to act as a 40 or a 50 year old, even when I'm with children. Then those children will respect me, fine, but they won't connect with me the way the Sahaba were connecting with the Prophet ﷺ. One of the other things that the Prophet ﷺ allowed the youth to be around him is, he allowed them to make their mistakes. He allowed them to make their mistakes. And there is not one collection, not even a hadith, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is losing his temper over a young Sahabi. There were many of them around him. And let's take an example. Anas radiallahu anhu. He comes into the service of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the age of 8. And when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam passes away, Anas is 18. Radiallahu anhu. So in between there, he has 10 years. And he says, Khadamtu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ashra sinin. I served the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for an entire 10 years. And in those 10 years, he says, he was the best. And never did he say to me, why did you do that, Anas? And never did he say to me, why didn't you do it? And he says, if one of his family members were to reprimand me or tell me off, because you know, he's a servant in the house. So he's a young boy who's bringing things to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, plates and cups and so on, right? So he's a young servant in the house. So when he was bringing things, obviously, what would an 8 or 9 or 10 year old do at times? You know, they trip over something. They thought they can handle too much, and then one thing drops off, right? And then they smash it and it breaks. So he says, when something broke at my, you know, at the service of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he broke because of me, his family members would tell me, Anas, be careful. Anas, we've told you before. Anas, look, you've broken it again. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, leave him. Now, why leave him? Doesn't the kid need to understand? Isn't this the prime way of getting our kids to learn? Yeah? Anas, why? Anas, again, doomed you are. You know, the kind of language that might come across this kid at the age of 10 is probably feeling that, that's it, I hope I don't serve these guys again. You know, like, I wish these guys just serve themselves and don't tell me what to do. That would be the reaction if you're telling them off again and again. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, look where he puts the situation. He says that if it was time for that utensil to break, then it's happened. You can't do anything about it. If Allah has willed that the cup is going to last, or the glass is going to last for, let's say, 7 years, and, you know, 2 months and 29 days and 59 sort of, you know, minutes or something like that, then when that moment comes, then that glass is going to break, because there is a qadr for that utensil. So if it's broken, it's finished. Just leave it. Now, you might say, okay, well, what about when the youngsters get challenging? Because all youngsters want to challenge you. And don't tell me the Sahaba radiallahu anhu ajma'in didn't have that inside them. You know, they would want to now and again be youth, as youth are. So once, according to the hadith, Anas radiallahu anhu says that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told me to go and do something, go to the marketplace. And I said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, No, I'm not going. And you know, I don't want you to sit there and think, Astaghfirullah, the Prophet asked him. No, guys, take it easy, yeah? This is just as the way they were with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the way you are maybe with your uncles, or maybe with your father, or actually a father figure. So sometimes, yes, we have something inside us, we just feel like saying no to something. It happens. It's a human thing. It's not that this person, the shaitan is this, and, you know, start to clamp him out and so on. So what did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do on this occasion? Anas radiallahu anhu says that I'm not going to go. He says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam just left him. Because look, think about how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is thinking. You've got a child who's challenging you right now. And it's not a big challenge. It's not like he's trying to disobey you openly. He just said, I just don't want to go right now. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he does is, he allows this child to continue. Because now, if a kid has told you that I don't want to do right now, and let's say you make him do it, then you made him do it when his emotions were really against your desires. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left him. And Anas radiallahu anhu went out, and he started to watch some boys playing by the roadside. And he says, after a while, as I'm watching these boys playing, because, you know, a young man, he wants to go out there, enjoy a match that is, you know, whatever is happening out there, whatever they're playing out there, he wants to see it. So he says that I noticed someone was behind me, you know, a shadow, whatever it was that gave it away, that someone was behind him. And he looked back and he saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was after a while. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, Anas, are you now going to do what I told you to do? In a nice, gentle, really appealing voice with a lot of love inside. And Anas radiallahu anhu said, of course, Messenger of Allah. And he went straight away and he did what he had to do. Now, what does this teach us? This teaches us that, you know, youngsters, they easily, you know, you can't fool, you know, you can fool people, but you can't always fool them. And young people, they have this vibe. Allah's given them this vibe. They know when you're saying something lovingly and when you're saying it because you just have got one against them. And is there anyone, I mean, I'd be surprised at this, but is there anyone who's sitting here when you were young, right? When you were young, you're a young kid, if you never had anyone in your life, when they were telling you off, and you felt like, he hates me, he hates me, he doesn't like me, and I know that, but I have to respect him, so it doesn't matter, I'm not going to speak. If you didn't feel that when someone's telling you off, and I know many people probably told us off when we were young, and some of them did it with a lot of love, perhaps many of them did it with a lot of love, we knew that they had love inside them. But there must have been one individual that you might have come across in your life that had that thing that you thought, you know what, this person just doesn't like me. And that's why he tells me off. Or partly he tells me off for that reason. If you've never experienced this, put your hands up. If you've never experienced any individual in your whole life like that, put your hands up. Hey guys, you know, can you look around, guys? You know, I don't see one hand up. You know. Yeah. We got a young kid there, put his hand up. Yeah. Good luck, son, yeah? Good luck, son, to life, yeah? We've all experienced it. And you can see, look, you got your own inside that tells you who's saying it with love and who's not saying it with love. In fact, you know, you go to madrasa or you start coming to a community place and you know who's got this hatred almost, like, you know, whoever does something, or especially you've done something and they want to take it out of you. The thing about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was that he had love continuous for all those who were around him. And it didn't matter what age you were at, and it didn't matter how old you were, how young you were, it didn't matter who you were, he had that love for you. And it didn't matter what color skin you had, he had the same love for those people who had dark skin as well as those who had light skin. He had the same love. There was no difference in the love. And he tried to find an excuse to give everybody a position. This was something unique about him. So everyone got something. So Ubayd ibn Abil Jarrah radiallahu anhu, he was known as the Amin of this Ummah. What does that mean? He was the trustworthy person of this Ummah. He had the treasury in his hand. If you look at, for example, Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhu, he later on becomes the Mufassir of the Ummah, one of the greatest Mufassirs. Why? Because he earned a dua. When did he earn that dua? He earned that dua at tahajjud time, and he earned it when he was with the Prophet ﷺ trying to, you know, read tahajjud with him. Which again is a unique opportunity for a very young person to get such a large dua of the Prophet ﷺ. And Prophet ﷺ, he didn't differentiate between one or the other. Bilal radiallahu anhu, he becomes a muadzin for life. He's the muadzin for life. And why did he choose muadzin? Even though the sahabi who saw the dream, he had the right perhaps to give the adhan, because he saw a dream about the adhan. He came running to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, I saw this dream. And when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard, he said, okay, that's good. And you know, this is a true dream. So we're going to give the adhan and call people to prayer. But he said, go to Bilal radiallahu anhu, go to him and tell him to deliver the adhan. Why? Because he has a sweeter voice than you. He has a sweeter voice than you. You know, I don't want to cause tension here, guys, yeah? You know, some of us here, you know, like, you're thinking, when's the day I'm going to give the adhan, yeah? And you think, okay, you know, you go and ask the guy, can I give adhan? He says, hey, listen, he says, I'm here, yeah? When I'm 6 foot down, yeah, it's him, yeah? And when he's 6 foot down, it's him, yeah? When he's 6 foot down, then probably you're probably in the queue. You know, you think, when is that thing, or what criteria is probably based on? People don't even know. But with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was clear that it was because of the sweeter voice. And of course, the way of saying the adhan properly with the ha, the ayn, all that was all correct for the different sahaba. But he chose Bilal radiallahu anhu according to the sunnah because of his sweeter voice. Why the sweeter voice? Because you're calling to a prayer. And when you're calling to a prayer, if it's a sweet voice, it actually lifts you up. Let's not joke about it. True or not, tell me, guys. You hear an adhan, and if it's a really sweet voice, it lifts you up. It lifts your whole, you know, iman up. Subhanallah, it gives you tingles down your, you know, spine. It says, Subhanallah, it's so nice. And you're in a nice mood to get closer to Allah. And that's the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to appoint such people. Anyway, I'm not here to cause a fight here, please, guys. Yeah, don't try and have a fight after that. I'm just giving you thoughts from how Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with the different sahaba. So here's Bilal radiallahu anhu. He's an African. He has no status in Arabia, but there's no differentiation between him and an Arab, and between him and Salman al-Farsi radiallahu anhu, who again was a sahabi who found proximity next to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Each of the sahaba, he tried to give them a post or a position or something they would do or something they would be known for. And he loved giving them names and he loved giving them titles. And even if it was for the sake of them getting a title because of something they did at a particular time, and they loved it, and they loved the kind of names he gave them. So he made all of them unique. So for example, he saw Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu had some kittens, and that's why he said Abu Huraira, because Huraira is a kitten and Abu means one who's got kittens. So, oh, one with the kitten, and that's Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. But we don't, you know, it became so famous, his name, that we don't even know his real name. There's even ikhtilaf in his real name, radiallahu anhu. What was his real name? He loved his name, Abu Hurairah, loved it so much that everybody started to use it, and he wanted people to use it because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave that name. Once he saw Sayyidina Ali, radiallahu anhu, again another young sahabi, lying on the ground, and you know, the dust had got onto his body. He said, Qum ya Aba Turab. Said, get up, O one of the dust, O one of the dust. And that became his kunya, that became a name that he loved to use, Abu Turab. Now, the love was there, the understanding was there. What else was there from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Well, what was there was that, what I said to you earlier in the reminder is that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would drop himself down to their level. Now, how much would he do so? Now, there are barriers, you know, let's not, you know, say there's no barriers. Of course there are barriers, but what do we find in the hadith? We find that in the hadith of Tirmidhi, that a sahabi walks in to the residence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he sees Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now this is our Prophet. If you think your imam is great, if you think your sheikh is great, if you think your mufti is great, if you think your peer sahab is great, if you think your Allah Peer Sahib is great, if you think his Peer Sahib is like, oh my God, if he came here, then everyone would die, you know, because of the awe of that Peer Sahib, yeah? So you need to look at the Peer of Peers, and need to look at the Mufti of Muftis, and you need to look at the most knowledgeable individual of this entire Ummah, which was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what state did he find him in? Well, he found Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was on all fours. So he had his hands on the ground, he had his knees on the ground, and his on his back were Hassan and Hussein radiallahu anhuma, both sitting on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and getting a little horsey ride. You know, horsey ride, a horsey ride. And who's giving this horsey ride? Who? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. Some of you guys thinking, nah, man, dive, brother. Nah, man, don't see that in my shaykh, you know. But the thing is, this is an acceptable source. The chain is Hassan. It's a good chain. And what happens is that the Sahabi seeing this, he straight away praises Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, what a great individual these two are riding. What a great individual the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that these two are riding. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam remarked, he said, what great riders they are. What great riders they are. Meaning that you're thinking that I've lowered myself in this position so low that you still have to praise me to show me status. Well, I'm giving them their status. Now, this is a grandfather to grandchildren, and he hasn't done this on one occasion. This is not a one-off occasion. This is a grandfather to his grandchildren, and what it shows is the level to which he dropped himself to the children's world, that they can find love and a playing grandfather who's going to do this for them at that age. Now, how old was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? At this age, he was probably 55 or more. 55, 56, 57, something around there. Because he was in the early days of Medina that both of them were born. They had to actually be of a maybe 1 or 2 years old for them to actually be, you know, able to sit on his back. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So we find this. Now, this is unique. Now he comes at the masjid according to a hadith in Muwatta Imam Malik. He comes at the masjid and he's got Sahaba radiallahu anhu ajma'in all around. They've all just come out the masjid. Now, when you come out of this masjid, you know, you've got all sorts of people outside and so on. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he notices a young boy. And what he did, when he noticed a young boy, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam darted towards that young boy. Who was that young boy? It was his grandson, Hussein radiallahu anhu. And as he went for Hussein, Hussein radiallahu anhu ran in a different direction. You know how you play, like, catch me if you can. Yeah? Play hard to get. So this was Hussein radiallahu anhu playing hard to get. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then tries to catch him. He goes around other people. He tries to catch him. He goes around other people. Finally, he catches him. And when he catches him, both of them are smiling, both of them are laughing, and then Prophet ﷺ, he picks him up and he kisses him. Radiallahu anhu. Now again, this is in front of Sahaba. So you know the thing was how Rasulullah ﷺ was so blending inside with his people. He was just a, you know, you could say that when he sat, they say this in the ahadith, when he sat down with his Sahaba, outsiders would come and say, which one of you is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Which one of you is that? Because they couldn't tell the way they were sitting. It wasn't like, you know, some kind of, you know, big time gaddi, you know, like, you know what I'm trying to say? You know, and like the amama is like maybe a bed sheet or something, right? Probably just took it from his bed sheet and tried it around. And like, you know, the scorn on the face tells you who the sheikh is. You know, I'm the man here, don't mess with me, yeah? They didn't even know who the Prophet ﷺ was in the gathering. Now, what Rasulullah ﷺ, he did over time is that he built this character and he molded it. These are not one-off incidents. These are day-to-day incidents that he had with them that they felt an attachment to. When he came out, the youth would run to him. The youth would run towards him to try and get his attention. You know, it's a bit different from these days, you know, like Mulisa walks out and everyone says, Mulisa, 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 Mulisa. You know, Mulisa. Get out of here. They run to him. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he would do is that he would stroke their heads out of mercy, out of love. And when he would stroke their heads, they would try and get the first stroke. This was the challenge, to try and get to him as fast as they could for the first stroke, because the natural pores of his skin that gave off the sweat from his hands, that was smelling of a beautiful perfume. And the first stroke of the first head got most of that perfume. And that's why they used to run towards him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And not only just run towards him and just get the perfume, they wanted to be around him. So you have a hadith in Bukhari where a group of individuals who were youngsters came to the masjid and they sought permission to stay in the masjid and to join the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at nighttime prayers. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowed them to stay inside the masjid for 20 nights, according to a hadith of Bukhari, for 20 nights. And they loved it. You know, this is almost like coming to the masjid, you're camping out, you're away from your family, but you're around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to try and get that, you know, get all the spirituality, the emotions and everything else that goes with it. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after 20 days, he asked them, he said, how are your family members? And he used to ask them in between. And after 20 days, he said, perhaps now your family members are missing you. And I suggest that you go back to your families. That's when he sent them back to his families. In fact, there's a hadith in Bukhari. This is Bukhari. Sahih hadith, there's no doubt about his sihah, about his authenticity. You know who came to his gathering to be a servant? A Jewish boy who was probably about 10 years old. A Jewish boy. This is so unique in the face of where we are, the world we're in. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had this Jewish boy stay in his presence for a long time until the Jewish boy became ill. And he became severely ill, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to visit the Jewish boy. And when he sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sensed that these are the last days of this boy, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to the boy's deathbed and he said to the child, just say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, just say it once. And the boy kept on looking at his father, his Jewish father, that, you know, I don't want to say it, I've got my father in front of me. And when he kept on looking, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam realized that the boy wouldn't say it unless his father gave permission. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned to the father and he said, could you give permission for your child to say these words? And the father gave permission, and that's when the Jewish boy said the shahada and he died as a Muslim. Allahu Akbar. Now, what does this show us? I mean, look at our world. You know, if we saw in some of our gatherings and so on, we see a non-Muslim come, it's a non-Muslim. It's like it's the other. You know, the other is the us, that's them. And here's Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, at the same time when the Jews and some of the Jews in Medina were plotting against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has a Jewish individual come to his house and serve him. You know what we would say? You know, jasus. You know, big time jasus. Mukhabarat. He's going to go out there and he's going to start telling them, you know, spy and so on. You can say what you want, but this is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is, you're at war with certain people, but just because they come from a particular race, you're not at war with the entire race. And there's a very deep thing that we've got to understand. Yes, you've got a problem with these certain people from this race, but the rest of the race shouldn't be tainted because of those people. And we need to learn this, because in a lot of our speeches, the way we speak, the way we might refer to certain people out there, we just say non-Muslims. We say non-Muslims, or we say the West, or we say these, you know, kafirs, innit? Kafirs, man, innit? And some even say Gora. You know, like white man, what Gora? Whoa, hang on a minute, don't we get reverts that are white that are coming to the religion? And it sounds really bad, because, you know, like sometimes it's actually happened once here. Yeah? Some guy saying Gora, and there's a white revert with us. And it's like, no, but you're not a proper Gora, innit? You're not a proper Gora. You're not like a proper Gora, innit? We're not. I mean, the attitude, how do you think that person probably feel that the references are being made about them? It's not about a whole race, it's not about a whole nation, just because a few individuals have done something. But anyway, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had this Jewish boy come to the faith because of the khidmah that he did, or the service he did in his own house. That shows the openness towards him. Now, there was a very, you know, there's a focal point of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is the spirituality which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had, that permeated, that went through every other aspect of his whole life. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to always be in dhikr. This is from our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. She says, "Kana Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam yadhkurullah fi kulli ahyani." He used to remember Allah azza wa jalla in every moment of his time. Every moment of his time. Now, what spirituality does is that it makes a person very humble. It makes them a people's person. And that's how he became. He became a people's person. Though, when he wanted his own time, he had his own time. This is a very clear distinction. You know, some of us, we become people's person, and we don't appreciate the time to ourselves. And some of us like to be enclosed, and we are introverts. We don't like to be with people so much. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam combined the two, and the only way he would do such a thing is the amount of dhikr that he had in his system. It connects him with Allah azza wa jal, that he sees every opportunity of trying to do good to someone as a way of making Allah azza wa jal pleased. Every opportunity, that's what he was. So when he's up to himself and he's doing his long rakats, that's part of him pleasing Allah. And when he's with people and trying to help them, that's part of pleasing Allah azza wa jal. And this is very unique in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because some shaykhs and some others, you know, they maintain their introvertness, and some maintain their extrovertness. Some, you know, shaykhs, they remain their, you know, they try to be to themselves. And it's their mizaj, it's their characteristic. There's nothing wrong with this. And if a shaykh becomes one who wants to see and meet a lot of people, that's his character. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam blended the two. Now, he wouldn't normally allow anyone to join him in his private moments, because he needed his private moments, his most private moments, to get close to Allah Azza wa Jal. But Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he sought a way of getting close to him at tahajjud time. So he went to his auntie's house, and his auntie was married to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he would wait till the night came when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be in his auntie's house, and he was sleeping in his auntie's house on the night when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was there. Now, Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he couldn't get much sleep because he's waiting for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to get up for tahajjud. And what he does is he tries to go two steps ahead. When Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to get up to go for his tahajjud, Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhu has already gone and he's prepared for him water, his utensil, everything he needs as he needs it there and then. And the Prophet ﷺ came out and he saw a whole water prepared for him to make his wudu. And he said, who did this? This is in the middle of the night. Who did this? And Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhu said, you know, it's me, a messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's when the Prophet ﷺ gave him that dua, that oh Allah, give him a deep understanding of this religion. And he gained that deep understanding and he became the mufassir of this ummah. But anyway, here's what happens. Is that Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he comes to join the Prophet ﷺ in the prayer. And when he comes to join him, he stands to his left. So Prophet ﷺ is here and Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma is right next to him on his left, just behind him. Now what a normal person would do, and this is another unique thing about the Prophet ﷺ, is that he used to try and find different ways of teaching children in a method that they would remember for life. If he had said, oh Abdullah, not on my left, come on my right, that could have been very simple just to say that. But he didn't. Prophet ﷺ took his hand, took it behind him, right up to the shoulder of Abdullah bin Abbas, and then gently tugged him until he brought him to his right. Now, why did he do that? And the Mufassir or the Muhaddithin have filled, you know, pages about this. Why did he do that? Well, one unique thing is, when you do that to a child and he's thinking, what's happening? Right? When he's thinking that, you're creating a whole sort of mystery inside his head. What is going on? Why is he doing this to me for? Right? And he moves into his right, and that's it. He knows that, well, this is the place I'm supposed to be. He remembers that for life. That, and it's in Sahih Bukhari in a few places about the time that he joined the Prophet ﷺ in tahajjud and how the Prophet ﷺ moved him towards his right. In another instance, Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he has a chance where he's on a conveyance with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hadith of Tirmidhi, he's managed to get right behind him on a conveyance, either a camel, most likely it's a camel, it could have been another conveyance, but anyway, if it's a camel, then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is ahead, he's sitting in at the front part of where you would sit, and Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhu is right behind him. Now, what happens is that when Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhu is right behind him, you can imagine a young boy, he's sitting right behind the biggest individual in the whole of this world. And as he's sitting, you can imagine how proud he would be to have others seeing him and so on. And at that time, being in that moment of, you know, how high, you know, you're high up there and you're next to the highest person as well. Prophet ﷺ takes that opportunity to teach him a hadith. And he teaches him some words, the words of which stay with him for life. He says, Ya Ghulam, O child. And Rasulullah ﷺ is not even turning behind to look at him and face him at this moment. Rasulullah ﷺ is riding this camel or whatever it was, and he's speaking from there. He's hearing the Prophet ﷺ, so when he says, Ya Ghulam, O child, and Abdullah bin Abbas, he replies saying, Yes, O Messenger of Allah. He says, I'm going to teach you some words. I want you to remember them. Now the Muhaddithin comment that Rasulullah ﷺ, what he did is that he took up that very unique opportunity, a very unique one, where a child's traveling with you. I don't know if you guys have tried it. You know, if you try and get something in your child's head, when you're at home, it might not drill as good as you got him in the car, in the front seat. You know, he's in the front seat, he's like, yeah, I've got the full view. Wow. Hey, man, I'm popular, man. You know, I can see everything. Back there, you know, in the back seat there with my other little brothers and sisters, I can't see anything. But when I'm in the front, yeah, I can see all of it. And at that time, if you try and knock something in his ears, I do this with my kid. It goes in nicely because it's like he's in the position of, you know, I've been privileged here. Where an adult sits, I'm sitting there. That's the sense. And there are times when I've talked to my child, my son is about 10, there are times when I've talked to him and he's in that front seat, he listens better and he'll remember far longer than other times when I've spoken to him in the house. And this is what the sunnah, the Prophet ﷺ, the sunnah that he taught to us, which is find unique opportunity to make them special and then give them a message. And the message he gave him was, know that if you preserve Allah, meaning that if you preserve His ways, Allah will preserve you. If you protect the ways of Allah on the earth, like what the deen of Allah, whatever it is, then Allah will protect you. If you fear Allah in the moments when you have got relief, then Allah will be there for you when your moments of grief are there. Now some of these words to the nearest meaning of what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, he gave him that hadith, and of course he remembered it for his life to narrate it back to us. Now, there's not much time. I'm just going to spend another 5-10 minutes, so I'll be done by then. I know some of you are getting itchy now. Isha Salah is done, Saturday night. I don't know what premiership you got going on. I don't follow these premierships, guys, yeah? And whoever's supporting any team, yeah, I don't care what team it is, you're a loser. You're serious, you're a loser. Because you know you're going to lose. Yeah, only one of you is going to win, right? One of you out of the whole premiership, whatever league it is, one of you, whoever you support, is going to get there. And the rest of you are all going to have sobby days, sad days. And I love it. Because as an imam, I know who's an Arsenal supporter, who's a Liverpool supporter, who's a Man U, who's a Chelsea supporter. And I keep in my head as a reference. And when I meet them, I say, yeah. Oh, what happened last night? Sorry, what happened last night? I heard Liverpool got, what was it? Was it 3-0, 2-0, what was it? And I rub it in properly. And why I rub it in is I tell him that, look, what's the point of supporting them, man? But tomorrow what happens is the Arsenal loses and I meet him and I tell him the same thing. And I rub it in all of them and tell him to stop supporting them. You know, if you want to be a football supporter, support the best team. Be clever, man. Be different. Don't go support just one of them and end up having a ruined 3 months just because your ones are bouncing off the bottom. You know what I'm talking about, yeah? Okay. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he chose these moments to teach his word. Now, another young sahabi radiallahu anhu was Ali radiallahu anhu. And Ali radiallahu anhu was 10 years old when he accepted faith. And he was in the household of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he got a lot from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because he was in the same house. One of the best moments that I see in all of this is that the faith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put inside them, and it wasn't because he gave lectures and lectures and lectures and lectures and lectures and lectures and lectures. I don't want to get you bored by this. And lectures and lectures and lectures and lectures. Yeah, it wasn't about that. It was about the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam demonstrating what he would have otherwise said. So you know, tawakkul, or depending upon Allah azza wa jal, they read it, they understood it first from his life before they understood it from his words. This is a very key thing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A lot of what you say, and you know, there's only a few ustads that one might be blessed with, a few teachers that have got this inside them. I've only had two teachers in my life that I would say that when I was in their presence, I could see sunnah after sunnah after sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in their lives. And they were living whatever they were preaching. And to see a person who is living what they're preaching is something out of this world, guys. I don't know how many ulama, mashayikh, I know they're all good. They've all got the good qualities. I'm not saying put anyone down who doesn't have this. Please don't get the wrong end of the stick. All I'm saying is that the ulama and the mashayikh are very good. But that shaykh or that person who lives everything he preaches, he's the best. So I'm not saying the rest are worse. No, I'm saying they're all good. But this one's the best. And you need to be in the company of the best to try and appreciate what the sahaba would appreciate. One individual I had in my life was Mawlana Fadhlur Rahim. And again, he's in Pakistan. He was ill. He's got a bit better. May Allah Azza wa Jal give him a healthy life and a long life. I mean, so thing was, when we were with him in Nottingham, it was so wonderful because you could go to him anytime you wanted. Anytime you wanted. And the best thing was, you could ask him anything you wanted. And when I say anything, I mean anything, like, you know, I'm saying anything. So you could ask from the skies to the earth, and from the extent of a man to the extent of a woman, whatever you wanted to do, you could do that. The sky's your limit. And we used to ask him whatever, and the best thing about him was he'd always give you an answer, and he would never have, you know, he would never sort of make you feel awkward. Never, never. In the 4 years I spent with him, never makes you feel awkward. Even when you've asked a silly question, a dumb question, or you've asked something that you shouldn't have asked him, is probably disrespect to him. Whatever you did, he used to say, "Mere pyare Hassan," say, "My beloved Hassan, this is the answer for that." And he would say it with a nice smile on his face. And when you meet, like for example, when you see him, that the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is in his life. So this sunnah I said to you about treating people equally and treating them from different levels and blending into their, molding into their sort of their level of understanding, that was Mawlana Fadhlur Rahim. He could drop from being with his 70-year-olds and 60-year-olds right down to us who were what, 15, 18, 20. That's our age at that time. And he would drop down to our levels. And he would speak to us so nice. And we knew that his love for me and love for so-and-so and love for you and love for you, there was no difference. He loved everyone equally. And that is very, very difficult to get as a sunnah in your life. And that's what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had. And the other person in my life is my own Shaykh, Mufti Rashidur Rahman Farooq. Sahib, may Allah give him a long life as well, in Bangladesh. Again, he's got that quality that he's got no differentiation between the most, the poorest man who's just walked out from the field with his, from the paddy fields, he's got mud all over from his, on his shins. He's just barged inside. I saw this with my own eyes. He's barged inside his room. The Sheikh is sitting there talking to someone from England, someone from Bangladesh, some scholar from Bangladesh, some scholar from England, and common people. And this guy barges in, right, with a lungi that's like half going from his belly button all the way to just about his knees, and he's got mud to the rest of it. Comes in and he barges inside. The Sheikh is speaking, and he comes, sticks his head right in front of Anuf and says, "Sheikh, please do some dumb on my head. You know, do some ruqya, just blow my head." Now anyone, if it was me or you, you know, we'd just say, "Yeah, you want ruqya? Bang, you know. What's wrong with you? You know, or you want ruqya? Yeah, I'll take you outside." Sheikh gave him ruqya, spoke to him nicely, smiled at him, said a nice few words with him, and just carried on with the rest of us, as if nothing happened. In fact, I saw, you know, when sometimes they, you know, sometimes they go crazy with their, I'll tell you, by 50, I will finish, okay? So I know some of you might get itchy right. 50, I'll finish, yeah. Is that okay with you guys? You want to carry on? If it's too long, then you hear my name next time. You say, I don't want to see your name. So anyway, with this point, what I was going to say is that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he lived the words he was preaching, he lived them. And when you see a person living that, you have such admiration for those people. So what did Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do on that occasion? He told Ali radiallahu anhu on the day of Hijrah to stay in his, you know, under his blanket where he would sleep. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had 13 men outside ready to kill him. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was with him, and only Sayyidina Ali in the house. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam takes some dust from his in his hand. He opens the door slightly. He blows. He says a few words of Surah Yasin. He blows the dust, and the dust travels, particles travel into the eyes of all the 13. So as they rub their eyes, that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam slips out with Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And this was with the will of Allah that happened. Who's left inside the house? Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he goes to Medina. What he said to Ali radiallahu anhu was, "Oh Ali, I will meet you on way to Medina." And that night, the 13 individuals were around, ready, still waiting for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to come out. They didn't see him come out. By morning, they barged into the house. And they saw a person lying under the blanket. And they thought that it doesn't look like him. So they unveiled the blanket and they saw Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. And he woke up. So yeah, you know. He woke up. They said, where is this? Where is he? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where is he? He said, well, you know, I'm here. You know. You guys be waiting outside, like, you know. And they asked Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu later on, did you not fear anything on that night when you were in that house and you knew 13 people are waiting with their swords to kill whoever's in that house? And his reply was, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told me that I'm going to meet him en route to Medina, I knew I couldn't die that night. I knew I couldn't die that night. Allahu Akbar. The dependence, you know, the belief in his words and the tawakkul on Allah Azza wa Jal is something which they only could have learned by being in the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anyway, what I'm going to do is I'm going to end it here. Wa akhir da'wan alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.
Allahumma salli ala sayyidina wa maulana Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa barik wa sallim. اللهم يا حنان يا منان يا بديع السماوات والأرض يا ذا الجلال والإكرام يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل نعم المولى ونعم النصير حسبنا الله لا إله إلا هو عليه توكلنا وهو رب العرش العظيم لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. Oh Allah, we ask you to make us those who make you pleased and you are pleased with them. Oh Allah, we ask you to make our faith grow within us by day and by night. Oh Allah, we ask you to make our feet steadfast in your path. We ask you to make us of those who truly follow the Qur'an and Sunnah. Oh Allah, we ask you to make us the beloved of your Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that on the Day of Judgment when we are resurrected, we find ourselves in his company and the company of all the prophets. Oh Allah, we ask you to make the pathway to Jannatul Firdaus easy for us, and make the pathway towards Jahannam difficult and impossible for us. Oh Allah, we ask you that you lift us up in spirituality. We ask you that you relieve us from the tensions we face. We ask you to make us clear our debts off. We ask you that you give us the blessings of this world and the next world. We ask you that any desire, any need we have in our hearts, that you fulfill it, if it is good for us and if you are pleased with it. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين آمين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.